Hi, welcome to the Grafana Alloy for Beginners series. My name is Mischa Thompson, and I'm a senior software engineer at Grafana. In the previous episode, we talked about ingesting and processing application logs. In this episode, we will cover generating logs from traces. These episodes build on one another. Before starting this one, make sure you've watched the first 11 and completed Alloy configuration sections 1 through 6 in the repo. To get started with our final section, open the Grafana Alloy for Beginners repo and scroll down to section 7. As a quick reminder, each section contains starter code, tasks that explain what you'll need to do, and a solution with the finished version. If you haven't already, fire up the learning environment and open config.alloy. Today, we're going to combine our knowledge of traces and logs to automatically generate logs from our application traces. I'll go over the pipeline we'll be building visually and then walk through the solution. Feel free to give it a try on your own first and then compare with the solution once you're finished. Let's look at our final pipeline. We're going to use the traces we've already been collecting to automatically generate logs. We'll start with our existing otelcol.receiver.otlp component, which is already ingesting spans from our mythical microservices. We'll then forward those spans to a new component, otelcol.connector.spanlogs. This spanlogs component is what will do the heavy lifting. We'll configure it to take the incoming spans, wait for a root span to arrive, and then generate a single log entry. By default, this log entry is in a JSON format that includes a body key, and the value of that key is the actual log line in log format that we're interested in. We will configure the component to only include the span attributes that we want in that body. We will then convert that log into Loki format using the otelcol.exporter.loki component and send it to our trusty loki.process. This is where we'll process the log line. We'll use a series of stages to do the following. First, we'll parse the outer JSON to extract the value of the body key, and we'll discard everything else. Next, we'll set the log line itself to the value that we just extracted. Finally, we'll use a log format parser to extract specific values from that log line and set those extracted values as labels. The process logs are then sent to the loki.write component to be exported to Loki for storage and querying. First, we'll configure the otelcol.connector.spanlogs component, giving it the component label autologging. The roots, spans, and processes fields control when a log line is generated. We've set roots to true to only generate a single log entry for each root span, which represents the start of a request. The other two are set to false. Otherwise, we would generate a log per span, which would be extremely noisy. The span attributes block specifies which attributes from the span that we want to include in our generated log line. We're including the http.method, http.target, and http.status code. Finally, the output block forwards the newly created logs to the otelcol.exporter.loki component for our next step in our pipeline. Next, we have that Loki exporter component, which is pretty simple, and its only purpose is to convert our incoming logs from OTLP into a Loki-compatible format. Once that's done, it forwards them to the loki.process.autologging component for further processing. Next, let's look at that loki.process component. This is where we'll process the logs that we've generated from our traces. So as before, the logs arrive in a JSON format, and it has a body key as well as some other additional metadata. For now, we're only interested in extracting the body key. To do that, we first use a stage.json block to parse the incoming log line. And this body equals empty string is a shorthand to say, look in the JSON for the body key and extract it as a temporary value also called body. So this is really the same as saying body equals string body. And we can now use that extracted value in subsequent stages. We'll set the actual log line itself, so the thing that will arrive to Loki, to be the value of that key that we just extracted, that body key. Next, we will parse that log line as log format and extract values from it, specifically that http.method, http.target, and http.status code that we just looked at. And these values will now be available in subsequent steps as HTTP method extracted, HTTP status code extracted, and HTTP target extracted, which we'll see in just a second. The stage.labels block now lets us actually set labels, you know, queryable stuff in Loki. And so what we'll do is we'll set the value method or the label method equal to this HTTP method extracted from the previous log format step. And we'll do the same for status and target. Next, the forward to block will then send these fully processed log lines to the loki.write.mythical component that we saw in section 1. Finally, we'll go back to the otelcol.receiver.otlp component from section 5. We're adding a new line to its output traces block, connecting it to our new spanlogs pipeline. This single receiver is now responsible for taking traces and forwarding them to two separate pipelines, one for direct trace storage and another one for generating logs from our traces. As always, once you're finished, make sure that you reload the configuration to make sure that the changes are applied. Once you're finished, scroll down to the verification section of section 7, navigate to the dashboards, and then go down to section 7 verification. You should be able to see the rate of span logs that are incoming, as well as the actual span logs themselves. All right, let's cover what we've done in the hands-on sections. So for our infrastructure telemetry, we're collecting Alloy's own logs. We're collecting metrics from Loki, Mimir, Tempo, and Pyroscope. We connected to a Postgres database and are covering metrics from that. For our application side, we are collecting metrics, traces, and logs all being sent to us by our mythical microservices, as well as generating logs from our spans using a span logs component. So what's next? In the next episode, Lisa will give an overview of the hands-on exercises designed to test what you've learned throughout the series.